Hi guys, welcome back for another video, and finally we get to put some colour on the exterior of the Toyota Supra. It's been a lot of work building up to this stage, so it's very exciting to see the car in colour. Now I'm going to split this into two episodes, and the reason I did that is because we had two booth loads. So the first booth load was all the parts such as the doors, the fenders, the hatch and the front bumpers, and then the second booth load was the actual shell, the front bumper, the spoiler and the fuel cap. So it's just easier if I split it up into two sections instead of having like a 45 minute episode, and I get to talk about more detail about the suppliers, the equipment, the processes and even some of the mistakes I made along the way. So let's get into this video. So this is the first booth load I was talking about, and as you can see there are a fair few body panels in this one booth load, and the reason we do that is the less booth loads we have to do, the quicker the day goes, and it's a very long and stressful day as it is, so the less booth loads we do the better. And all the body panels have been nicely spread out from one another, so I can actually comfortably move around the body panels when I'm painting it and not make contact with them, which is also nice. Now this is my friend Preston, he's a massive help, pretty much couldn't have picked a better person to give me a hand with this sort of stuff, very pedantic and does everything 110%. Going back to what I was saying, it is a long day, this is more than a two person job to smash this out in a day, so any help is definitely appreciated, so thank you Preston, you freaking legend. So in the previous episode, you guys saw me give the panels a very thorough clean with wax and grease remover and the grey Scotch-Brite, and right now, that's pretty much what we're doing. Spraying down the panels to make sure that they're all nice and straight, nothing got damaged in transit, and then we're using microfiber towels instead of like lint-free towels to give the panels a nice clean. I find that these pick up really nicely. I saw this tip from Motivated Painters online and figured I'd give it a shot, and I'm absolutely in love with how this picks up the moisture and all the dirt that's actually on the panel, so a method that I'm definitely going to stick to. Probably not the most economical way of doing it if you are a smash repair shop, but for the amount of cars I paint a year, probably like 2 to 5 cars, this is more than fine where, you know, consumables and materials aren't really something that we worry about too much because they are long projects and restorations. So our main goal is to have a nice off-the-gun finish, whether that be, you know, the base coat going down, the clear coat not being too orange peely, or just dust and debris in general. So here you can see me giving the cups a nice clean, because obviously there will be paint over time, whether it's primer or painted out of these pots. It becomes flaky over time, so even though your panel might be perfectly clean, at the end of the day, whatever is on your suit or on your equipment can also potentially end up in your paintwork. So clean everything. So this is actually the second mistake of the day. I realized, holy shit, I'm not gonna have enough paint to actually paint this car. The first mistake was rocking up 30 minutes late to our session. That was definitely my fault. And yeah, I sort of underestimated how much paint was gonna be needed for this two-door car. I like to be left with a little bit of paint afterwards for any touch-ups or any future things, like if the bonnet just gets completely caked in rock chips and we need to paint it, it's good to have the original paint that you painted the whole car with for it to properly color match, and so you wouldn't have to blend into other panels. Figured, you know what, run back to the boys over at Global. I was on the phone and they already had the paint mixed up by the time I got there, and it was just a matter of putting everything back into the actual tin, mixing our existing paint with our new paint just so everything color matches perfectly, getting in the booth and putting some paint down. So yeah, stupid mistake, what do you do? But for future reference, I'm just going to order an extra liter every single time like I've been doing so far, and I've never had problems before, so don't know why I did anything differently this time. So the way I like to paint is I always start with the tricky to get two sections and then I work my way out. The exterior of the panel is really the most important part at the end of the day, and that's what I like to finish off with. So when we're looking at the door, I'll start from the inside of the door and I'll slowly work my way into the door jambs, down the edges, and then start from the bottom and work my way to the top of the door. The whole time I've got full fan, full trigger, and I'm working side to side, making sure that I've got full coverage on this panel. Now the base coat we're using is the Spies waterborne system. I've said it before, I'll say it a million times, so thank you Sam from Donnybrook Accident Repair Center for actually showing me this system, because this thing is an absolute lifesaver. I can paint the whole car pulled apart, I don't get any tape marks or tape edges. When I put the car back together, I've got full coverage, I've got, you know, panel to panel are all matching, even when I paint metallic cars, and I'm very, very happy with the results I get with this base coat. It also lays down very nicely, and it's a fast system, so it's 1.5 coats, and the moment I'm done with that panel, I don't have to come back to it till the clear coat stage. So I've said it before, if you need any paint supplies for any project or any budget, go visit the boys at Global Auto Coat if you're in WA. So your first coat is you have your full coverage. I like to overlap approximately 75%. Now in reality, I could probably move a little bit quicker. And then the second coat, or what's considered a drop coat or a half coat, is you just pull the gun back a little bit from the panel and you dust your base coat into your already existing wet paint straight away. You don't want to wait, you don't want to let it dry, because then what will end up happening is it'll become textury or a little bit rough. You want to be dusting this coat straight into your wet paint, and especially very important on your flat panels such as roofs, bonnets, or even boots, just to make sure that you don't get any stripes going on like I did when I painted my R34 Skyline for the first time. So the fender I just painted, we got the first coat on, but unfortunately the camera tripod let go and I didn't get a chance to film the drop coat, so here's the drop coat on the other fender. So here's a time lapse of me painting the front bumper. The real time was approximately 5 minutes. I really wanted to make sure to take my time and get those tricky to get to sections first, such as the edges, the vents and all that. So as you can see, I'm working from one side of the bumper to another. I'm keeping that consistent wet edge. I keep checking my work just to make sure that all the edges are nice and covered, because the last thing you want is you put your car back together and there's a little bit of primer showing through where you didn't put enough base coat or you didn't put enough clear coat in sections. So really do try your best to take your time with it, because this is the last stage. The painting does really take the least amount of time. The prep work is what takes the time. So if you spent all this time doing the prep work, doing the hard work, and then you just messed it up because you rushed the painting stage like I did in a couple of sections on this car that I will show you guys very soon, it's a bit of a bummer, because it's like, did these 24 hours really matter to me that much when I've put like 2 or 3 months worth of work prior to this? So now I'll take a moment to talk about the clear coat stage, some things I did wrong, and in the next video I will talk about both the base coat gun and the clear coat gun that I used, along with the settings of how the guns are set up. Very, very satisfied with how the base coat gun sprays along with the clear coat gun, but there's just a little bit of tweaking to do in my technique when it comes to the clear coat to get those nice finishes. So I have used this exact gun with the exact settings in the past and received results that I'm very happy with, but this time around, being a warmer day, and I did get pretty cocky with it, we got some major runs in the two doors and the front fenders that we're going to have to rectify. As for the amount of coats applied, I applied 2 coats to all the plastics, 3 coats to the exterior of all the metal parts, and 1 coat to the inside of the door jams. So the step-by-step process of doing it is I applied 1 coat to the inside of the door, 1 coat to the outside of the door. Then I repeated the same process on the other door. Now, as for the fenders, because they only have edges, you know, that go in the engine bay and into the door jamb, they also received 3 coats. So, as mentioned, all metal panels received 3 coats, and all plastic bumpers received 2 coats. And waiting for about 15 minutes between coats, hopefully that makes sense. Nothing too hard, but yeah, the clear coat stage is certainly quite a bit more finicky compared to the base coat stage when teamed up with my DeVilbiss DB1 and the Spies Hecker waterborne system, which is, as I mentioned before, pretty idiot-proof stuff.